I see you. Welcome all back to the channel. I'm Mrs. Moonstomper.
And I'm Mr. Moonstomper. Guys, it's great to have you on board. Thank you for stopping by and tuning in. You've all seen the thumbnail, you all know exactly what it is. What is this?
Punk!
Absolutely. So what is punk, Mrs. Moonstomper?
Well, the word punk describes a hoodlum, a ne'er-do-well, like a youngster. A youngster in society who doesn't particularly follow our rules or regulations. Plus, as far back as the 1500s, the word punk was used for prostitute.
Well, there you go.
Yeah,
you've heard it from the encyclopedia yourself. Well, what can I say about that, Mrs. Moonstomper? So, what I know about punk is it's not just about 1977 in the UK, which is the bits that I really remember. It actually starts early, and that's the late 60s.
Yes,
it doesn't start in the UK, funny enough, it actually starts in the USA.
It does.
Because that's more of a USA word than it is a UK word.
That's it.
And it was used for the first explanation you gave. Mainly used for that explanation.
Yes, yes.
In America.
Uh-huh.
And you've got to think back to 1969 and the late 60s, actually.
Yes.
So, you know, 69 is probably not quite there, but it's there or thereabouts. And you've got to think of shock rock, theatrical rock. People such as Alice Cooper.
That's it.
Who went onto the stage with boa constrictors, guillotines. And
swords
just,
as well.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, always reminds me of Coney Island.
Yeah, me too,
reason.
Yes.
It's that kind
Touch of
thing.
Touch of the Coney Islands going on.
But digging a little bit deeper, bands like the Stooges.
Oh yes, Iggy and the Stooges.
Absolutely, all the Stooges as
oh,
it was
right.
then.
Oh, I see.
Then you've got the MC5, Velvet Underground, and you've then got the New York Dolls.
Oh yes.
So there's a little bit of confusion as to where it started. Did it actually start in Detroit or New York?
Oh,
I think New York.
And some parts of Michigan as well.
Absolutely. But New York for probably the most famous.
That's it, yes.
And moving forward, in fact, no, staying in that era.
Okay.
It was different. Mm. It's completely different to the punk that we know in the United Kingdom.
Yeah.
But that music is born out of protest.
Yes.
That's when that music really comes to force. So in the United States in the late 60s, early 70s, people were protesting about the war in Vietnam.
That's it.
Women's rights and other bits and pieces.
There's just so many to name, weren't
there? And people just do that all the time. So
yes.
Whether you're politically swayed or not, I'm not particularly. I don't really like to pin my colours to the mast too much because I think they're all as bad as each other in politics. But I always thought, and you always thought especially, that politics and music
shouldn't cross paths.
Yeah, they don't mix, do they?
I know.
However,
it can't be helped sometimes, can it?
No, it can't, but especially when it comes to things like that.
Yes.
So, punk rock, really, as it's named, punk rock, is a kickback at the authorities.
That's it.
It's a kickback at anything that's on point, that's controversial.
Oh, yes.
So punk is really a counterculture,
yes.
Subculture, but some might say a counterculture.
Yes.
Although I don't use that word, but some just might say a counterculture.
That's it, some, just some.
So punk actually came to the United Kingdom, and it sort of rocked up in the early 70s.
Yes.
And it rocked up from a group called the Ramones. Found by, if you watched our John Peel video, you'd have seen that John Peel actually played the Ramones in the UK, and they came to the UK, did a couple of gigs, I think it was in the mid 70s, and bands that sprung up in the United Kingdom out of that. But there's an important part to all that, so there's a little place called CBGB's. in New York.
Yes.
So what do you know about CBGBs and Mrs. Moonstomp?
It's a bluegrass club. It used to be a dive bar.
That's a dive bar, biker bar.
Yes, yes.
And they, I think they did it, was it 1973, December 73, yeah, early 74?
That's it, 73 into 74.
Where it first started,
mm.
And bands like the Ramones,
oh, yes.
MC5, yes. EE, the New York Dolls, they all played there.
That's it.
Because that was the place to play.
Mm.
Although it was small, that was where you were going to get your name heard.
Yes.
And so punk began,
mm.
But there's a marked difference.
Okay.
So the marked difference in the United States was punk was very underground.
Mm.
It wasn't mainstream at all. It was just a counterculture in the United States. In the UK, it was exceptionally mainstream. Exceptionally,
yes.
It became massive through fashion, through music, through just the attitude.
Mm.
So
there's always attitude in that.
Absolutely. So what do you actually know about punk and Mrs. Moonstomper?
Well, like you just said, the fashion, the attitude, and some of the punk rockers or the punk followers, they had the spiky hair.
But they didn't in the United States.
Okay.
That's where everybody thinks punk's all the same.
I do beg your pardon.
But they don't in the
United States. No, I just thought. They just came as you saw them, didn't they?
So the United States, yes. It was about the stripped. It was just stripped back. It was rock and roll, it was stripped back.
Yes.
It was, and that's what it's called, punk rock.
Okay.
So, you know, rock and roll is, you know, that's from people like, you know, Little Richard, Jerry Lee Lewis,
yes.
Bill Haley in the Comets, you know, Eddie Cochran. Those kind of people.
Yes.
And even before then, it stems from blues music.
That's
actually.
From way back.
Yeah. A blues and jazz,
mm-hmm.
To be precise. And it just sort of, it became the, pardon the expression, it became the bastard of
mm-hmm.
blues and jazz.
Oh, yes. And a good way to describe that.
Yeah, it did. And with that, it became almost purist.
Okay.
It became very, even melodic, even very complex, for no other reason than it was just complex,
yes.
Because they were very flash musicians, very, very good accomplished musicians. Mm. When punk started, punk rock.
Yes.
So, and that's why the theme is called punk rock.
Oh.
Because it was very stripped down, very, very basic. Very fast.
That's it, yes.
Exceptionally loud. Just really, it was raw.
Gosh.
It was just smack, it was in your face. And that's how it went. In the UK, it was different.
Yes.
Completely different.
Uh-huh. Well, going back to the way the Americans dress, you get the like the MC5 with the leather jacket and the jeans and all that, like sort of almost psychedelic flower power esque.
Well, they wore, some of those wore like, almost like blouses, like sort of
yes.
flowery sort of shirts, but that was the fashion in the late 60s, right?
Yes.
And
then you get the Ramones with the leather jackets and the tight jeans.
That's what it was, four leather jackets, four
yes.
biker jackets, four pairs of tight jeans, long hair.
That's it.
Bang, have it.
And the New York Dolls, they were a bit different. The lead singer, for instance, he wore like a blouse on type thing. Tight trousers, like a crop top.
Yeah.
Tight trousers, stilettos, and he had the full makeup on.
He did. So he looked like, if you're British, you'll know Audrey at Coronation Street. If you're not British, we'll put a picture on the
like
screen.
Like a young Audrey.
Yeah, we'll compare the two. But
yeah.
The New York Dolls, if you listen to things like Personality Crisis,
yes.
then go and listen to the Rolling Stones, Brown Sugar.
Oh, yes.
And you can hear that. It's like a 12-bar blues riff in the background. And you can see where
there's a bit of a similarity.
There's a hell of a similarity. It's the same bloody riff. It's just slightly changed, you know, but it's the same. It's almost the same riff pattern. It's the same chords, but just slightly rearranged.
Yes.
And
the way he dances as well, you can put Jagger next to him. And there's a very strong similarity as well.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Very
I completely agree. Completely agree. Oh, and the Ramones were the dead opposites.
Yes.
They were just almost, it was just no nonsense.
Mm.
This is our song. it's going to be 2 minutes, an absolute, we're going to make your ears bleed, and the whole LP was over in 20 minutes.
I see, plus most of the music just stopped dead, didn't it, at the end? There's no, like, fade out.
No crescendo, no great big ending,
just...
Bang, that's it, yeah. Started like that, and then bang, like that, 2 minutes, you know, and it's just like, whoa.
That was their style.
Yeah, absolutely amazing. When that came to the UK, we hadn't really seen anything like that in the UK.
No, we hadn't.
There were bands starting to be like that.
Yes.
But nothing that fast, that loud, that heavy. And the amount of bands that spawned out of that, there were bands such as Motorhead.
Oh, yes.
Who, you know, and if you look at Motorhead, he'll cite, you know, Lemmy, God rest his soul, he cited the Ramones,
yes.
The Damned as well, amongst other sort of bands that spurned, that have got that Motorhead sound,
oh,
but
yes.
It was just like an absolute wall of noise. I've been lucky enough to see Motorhead a few times.
I know.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Obviously, people can't do that anymore, can they?
No, it's a shame.
So, looking at the British punk, sort of moving across to the British punk.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, let's show the viewers a quick VT while we're going to have a cup of tea. And
why not?
We'll come back in a moment.
Enjoy.
So, brew, Lou.
In a few.
Absolutely. See you in a moment, guys.
London Calling 2016. Crowded, fast-paced, and buzzing. Easily one of the most recognizable cities in the world. From the Queen's Guard at Buckingham Palace to double-decker buses. From the famous red phone booths to London's punks. Yes, punks. Apparently as British as high tea and cucumber sandwiches these days. 40 years after they ripped across the face of this country like a razor blade, they're now being feted by the establishment. Even the Sex Pistols are being celebrated, the most vilified band in Britain back in the 1970s.
It's quite hard to get across. It is just the absolute shock that punk had. I mean, you can see it in some of the exhibits we've got here. It's a very, very rare record, God Save the Queen.
The British Library is just one of several venerable institutions celebrating punk Britain this year, unearthing its audio collection and a host of memorabilia.
Some of the t-shirts are really quite provocative, and even today people find them slightly controversial.
The Sex Pistols and the bands that would spring up around them knocked the prog rock bands right off the stage with a howling screech against the establishment designed to provoke.
You know, people have an idea of what punk rock is, and we're trying to just sort of take them back and say, this was the beginning of it.
The style and the music are called punk rock. Imagined in real violence, sadism, and self-torture are in.
To listen to old newscasts, you'd think that aliens had landed from outer space, or that the nation's young had been seduced by a dangerous cult in an act of mass hypnosis.
The clothes are wild. One favorite, a dress made from a bin liner. Canadian translation, a green garbage bag.
The initial punk phenomenon lasted only a few years. But those angry three-chord riffs have reverberated through the decades. It was a product of its time, rising unemployment, race riots, and Margaret Thatcher waiting in the wings.
There was a real air of despondency, and the song that's become known as God Save the Queen was actually originally called No Future.
God Save the Queen! The fascist regime! It became a punk anthem, got them banned from the airwaves, and increased violence towards young people on the streets, finding their expression through punk fashion. She ain't no human being. All these years later, Matlock says he's not particularly bothered by the royal family. Punk lost its fire just a few years in.
But my worry with punk is that it's a bit people reliving the past, but I think it's human nature. You know.
Welcome back, everyone. I really hope you enjoyed that VT.
I certainly did. So here's a question for you before we delve into the sort of the actual sort of meat of the subject, which is probably looking at UK punk. And the only reason I say it's the meat of the subject is because that's the subject I kind of grew up with. That's the subject we would really know because we grew up in England. If you grew up in the States, Australia as well. Now, Australia had punk bands as well. Let's not forget our cousins down under, because they did.
In Canada as well.
Did indeed.
Yes, lots of other places.
So, those, right, so bands such as the Patti Smith Group, The Damned, Blondie, The Pretenders.
Oh, yes.
Those bands that all sprung up around about the similar time in the 70s. When
yes,
they sort
late
of,
70s.
Well, no, mid-70s actually, those guys were around. How did they get dragged into the punk scene? Because I don't know the answer to that.
Okay.
Apart from they were labelled as punk.
Yeah, so I know, I'm a bit baffled as well.
Yeah, because I don't see the correlation. There's a bit of a correlation with the music, admittedly, because it's normally like fast and over quick.
That's it.
But then when I look at the Pretenders and I look at Blondie and I'm like,
the Sex Pistols, you can understand, because they're proper punks. But like you said, Blondie, Pretenders.
Yeah. Well, the Sex Pistols made themselves, didn't they? They saw the Ramones. And they went, we're going to have some of that.
Okay.
Now, England was in a crap state that point in time. Politically, it was on its backside for many, many reasons. But it always is, isn't it, really, England? And it was, that was a kickback at the authorities. That was protest, pure protest.
Of course.
So,
Mr. Moonstomper, how did Malcolm McLaren get involved with the Sex Pistols?
Well, the Sex Pistols, right, they started in the sort of in the mid 70s. Now, McLaren was already involved in punk, little do people know.
Okay.
And he was an advisor actually to the New York Dolls, would you believe? From, I think it was, I've got a feeling it was 70, maybe 74 to 76, something like that.
Yes.
But he had a shop in Soho, a boutique shop, and his girlfriend at the time, which was
Vivian Westwood, yes.
And it was that shop was called Sex, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. Yes.
And it was basically it was a fashion boutique, but it was also it sold bondage wear and it sold outrageous stuff.
That's it, whips, chains.
Yeah. And so Malcolm McLaren and Vivian Westwood were kind of the early architects of subculture, punk subculture in the United Kingdom. They were the ones who were pushing the fashion, selling the fashion, driving it, and young and up and coming bands were seeing that and they were going, wow, actually, that's quite shocking. Now, Malcolm McLaren was known for his shock tactics, such as where you mentioned New York Dolls personality crisis. It had been Malcolm McLaren who would have said to the New York Dolls, look, guys, dress up as women. Dress up as drag queens, you know, because that is absolutely shocking. It was in the 70s. It was like, it still is now, to be quite honest with you. I genuinely don't expect that, but,
it doesn't surprise me these days.
No, it doesn't surprise me, actually. But it's when you look, it's like, whoa. It wasn't the norm, was it?
No, not really.
And the one thing you can say about Malcolm McLaren is his ability to shock was absolutely outrageous. Now, he recruited Johnny Rotten.
Okay.
He recruited him and he groomed him in the nicest sense.
Okay.
Now, punk, when you look at punk, it looks very working class. Now, skinhead and two-tone and scar and rude boy and all those subcultures, countercultures, whatever you want to call them,
yes,
they are very, very working class and rooted.
They are rooted
yes, into working class. The lifestyle goes with the music, and that's just the way it is. Punk was a little bit different.
Yes.
It was a kickback of the authorities, and the Sex Pistols were very middle class, actually, apart from Sid Vicious, who wasn't so middle class. But John Lydon, also known as
Johnny Rotten,
was middle class.
Yes, yes.
But they actually knew what they were doing. They knew exactly what they wanted to do. So when they came out with God Save the Queen, because any of the Queen's Jubilee was coming up, Silver Jubilee in 1977, that was probably the most shocking record of all time. It was brilliant. It was absolutely brilliant, but it was a kickback.
Yeah, we mentioned Mary Whitehouse as well. We mentioned Mary Whitehouse in our John Peel video. She again, had to stick her oar in and ban that song.
The BBC banned it.
Oh, right.
Everybody banned it. Nobody wanted that song. It was just absolutely outrageous. It was treasonous. It was blasphemous almost. It was absolutely everything. But Malcolm McLaren, being the absolute promo artist that he is, decided to put the band on a barge on the River Thames and go straight past the Houses of Parliament playing that at full pelt. He got arrested. Can you believe? Would you get arrested now? I don't know. Other bands have done other things similar since, haven't they? Yeah. U2 did something.
Went on the roof to
They did. Rage Against the Machine.
Yes.
I think they did as well, didn't they?
They did, yes.
And Fred Durst,
From Limp Bizkit.
Limp Bizkit, they did one where they appeared to get arrested as well.
Okay.
So that became quite a shocking thing to do. But you can see where other bands are copied. That came from Malcolm McLaren.
Okay.
Because he just had that PR brain. But whenever he looks at punk and they go, oh, punk, it's a London thing, it wasn't. The Buzzcocks from Manchester.
Okay.
Who were absolutely brilliant. Then you've got the Undertones.
Oh, from Ireland.
Stiff Little Fingers, also from Ireland.
Irish as well.
And from Scotland.
You got the Skids.
The Skids.
Yes.
The Skids were really punk. They were really, really banging in your face.
Really energetic with the way he dances as the lead singer.
Yeah. And then you've got the other bands as well, such as the female bands.
Right.
Polystyrene.
X-ray Specs.
Wow. There you go.
Yes. Well, we get female singer, but the rest are male.
Yeah.
And Susie and the Banshees as well.
Now, Susie and the Banshees, I think that was actually New Wave post-punk.
Oh, right.
Because that was a bit later. But then also roped into that scene as well, you had The Clash.
Oh, yes.
And to my mind, The Clash were, I'll say it, what have I always said?
To you, they're like a pub band.
They are.
They sound like a pub band.
They do, because my band used to look like that and sound like that, and that's just the way it was. But I'm not saying they're a bad band.
I think they're good.
They're absolutely brilliant. They really were. They just, literally, they were pioneers.
Yes.
They really were. They did so much for race relations.
Oh, yes.
When they
Rock Against Racism.
Rock Against Racism. That was amazing.
Yes.
It really, really was. But other punk bands as well. I mean, where do you even start with those guys?
I know. Some you wouldn't deem as punk, like XTC, Talking Heads.
Now, again, those to me were new wave. So when I look at XTC and Andy Partridge, who was another absolute brilliant musician.
Yes.
I don't see the punk correlation, but I see the new wave correlation.
Oh yeah, that's true.
And new wave kind of sprung out of punk.
Okay.
So the to me, the music didn't die.
Mm.
The music just got slightly more...
Sort of faded.
No, I think it got more melodic.
Oh, right. That's...
It got more melodic. Mm. It got not so protesty.
Oh, right.
Because we started to go into some sort of a settled period almost.
Yes.
Where England started to settle down.
Mm.
And nobody got any songs to protest about. What can you protest about? There was nothing to shout about, was there?
Absolutely. All that unrest sort of died down, didn't
yeah.
it? All the civil unrest.
Of course it did.
Other sorts of unease.
Yeah, so what did English punks wear? Then what's the difference between those and USA punks?
Well, the English punks had either spiky hair or the mohawk.
Or coloured hair as well.
Yeah, coloured. Like spike, really long spikes. Shaven on the side and spikes in the middle.
So a Mohican.
The Mohican or Mohawk. Mm-hmm. T-shirt, ripped T-shirt, slogans emblazoned across.
But that's, some of those slogans are offensive.
Yes.
Really highly offensive T-shirts.
There was.
And the idea was it was two fingers up to society.
Mm.
A great big F you. We're gonna do what we want to do.
That's it. And nobody's going to stand in our way. So
yeah. So I butted in there, Mrs. Mayne.
It's all right.
What else did they wear?
There was sometimes a shirt as well. Leather jacket, denim jacket, bondage style trousers with the braces. Chains, studs, maybe a collar around the neck as well.
Lots of piercings as well.
Piercings, safety pins through the nose or the ears. Doc Martens or Bluffer Creepers.
Cool.
Yes.
Cool. And then that fashion just died as quick as it came, did it not?
Yes.
But the bands didn't die, did they?
No.
The music didn't die, so that went into new wave.
Oh yeah, sort of changing lanes.
It did, and then when you sort of get to 77, 78, that becomes my sort of favourite era of music.
Oh, yes.
With bands such as XTC, when they were just starting out, Susie and the Banshees.
Yes.
Weird fact for you, Robert Smith from The Cure, who was in Susie and the Banshees.
Oh, yes, I forgot about that.
In that.
Yes.
How bizarre is that? But that became sort of... She paved the way for goth.
That's it, yeah.
Because
you can see she's got the dark, sticky up hair.
And the makeup.
Yeah, it's just like Robert Smith as well.
Yeah.
In the
Cure. Absolutely. But
the comb back hair.
But she, you mean back combed hair. That's exactly what it's back combed. Not that I know about back combed hair. You know, I think I might have back combed mine one too many times, but there you go, guys. But yeah, she paved the way for that.
Yes.
But in amongst all that, you still had the Clash.
Yes.
Then
Stranglers.
The Stranglers as well. Now the Stranglers to me are an amazing. Now I badge those alongside the Clash for that very pub rock, but the Stranglers could be really melodic, and they had so much longevity in them.
Yes,
they did. So when you listen to Golden Brown, that's completely different to something Better Change or Peaches or...
Or the early stuff like Go Buddy Go.
Yeah, yeah, completely different.
Yeah.
And The Damned as well. When you listen to The Damned, you listen to Eloise, that's just like... That's just
called chop and change lanes with the tones of music.
They did, but spawning out of those, sometimes people would jump off. People like Captain Sensible.
Mm. Now, he was from The Damned.
He was, and he did. Was it Happy
Talking?
And wasn't that from the South
Pacific film?
Whoa, okay, we might put a clip of that on the screen. I don't know if we can find it, we might put a clip. If it is, then it's coming up now.
Like a lily on a lake.
can still see the punk elements in it.
Yes.
It's the two fingers up to everyone. I'm going to do what I'm going to do, and I'm going to enjoy it. So the rebel in those people it's there, isn't it? They're rebels.
They are
proper renegades.
They're forever rebels.
Yeah, you can't take it out of them. You can't.
That's a phrase to express.
But, you know, when bands like this, so going back to the 70s, when the Sex Pistols split up and they announced that split so quick, they were in New York when they announced this. I think Johnny Rotten basically he just upped and went and he just said, I'm not coming back, that's it, I'm done. And they were just about to embark on a US tour at the time, but that's it, you know, at that point in time, punk pretty much died. Because the other bands, there was just no longevity in it, was there?
Okay.
And the rip-off as well. So the way those guys were ripped off and they were used by record companies.
Yes, oh God, yes.
Where the Sex Pistols actually wrote a song about EMI and how EMI had actually ripped those guys off royally. But they did.
I know.
They absolutely did. They exploited those guys, they ripped them off. And those guys ended up with pretty much nothing, to be honest with you.
Just because they're young, they took advantage of them.
But they do. They do. That's the music industry.
Yeah.
It really is. And it's gone all the way through. It really has. Even Black Sabbath were taken advantage of.
Oh, yes.
Where they wrote an LP called Sabotage. But literally, they were ripped off for everything because they were just given advances all the time. They weren't given any money. All the money they were giving them belonged to the record company, so they were
just in one hand and out the other.
Yeah, because their manager and the record company just absolutely threw it at the wall. But there you go, that's rock and roll for you.
Awful. The time when you said the Sex Pistols were in New York, is that when Sid Vicious was dating Nancy Spungen? Was that around about the time?
It was indeed.
Okay.
Now, right, so on this channel, you notice we don't dig dirt on people.
No, we're going into much or delve into much detail.
Yeah, and we know the background. We know the background of lots, and we could have said lots about, you know, previous videos, lots about John Peel. We could have said lots about about The Who, Madness, about loads
Rude Boy as well.
Yes, absolutely. We could see lots and lots.
Oh,
and
yes,
lots.
Yes.
And I think those are detrimental things.
Yes.
And they're there, it's documented, it's in history, and I don't think there's any need to rake up that because I don't think it makes for a positive vibe at all. Suffice to say, what happened to Sid Vicious was really, really good. Desperately sad.
Yes.
Desperately sad.
Was.
But he was another one who was taken advantage of. And later on, John Lydon, so Johnny Rotten, always said he regretted getting Sid Vicious into the band. He regretted it bitterly.
He was only 21 years old, wasn't he?
He was. But they knew each other. They knew each other. And John Lydon kind of thought, you know what, I'm taking a real chance here, because he knew that Sid Vicious was an absolute, he was a wild man.
He was.
And John Lydon knew that, but John Lydon knew when to stop.
Okay, yes.
He knew when to stop, and he was really, really, he's a very, very clever person. Sid Vicious wasn't like that.
No.
In fact, Sid Vicious couldn't take him by the bass. At all, he couldn't play notes on the bass guitar, and they had to teach Lemmy from Motorhead trying to teach him. Lemmy just said he's beyond teaching. I can't teach him this, he's beyond teaching. But there you go, and that's a good book you should read. Lemmy's White Line Fever.
Yes.
That will give you a taste of the what happened in the 70s.
Yes.
Such as the Pretenders. When they started. What were they going to call themselves?
Oh gosh, dare I say it. The Moors Murderers.
I mean, wow.
I know.
And Lemmy. turned around and he said, I advise you actually don't do that, guys, because you will never ever be played on radio. And the only reason he said that? Because before he was going to call himself Motorhead, he called himself, what was the?
B-A-S-T-A-R-D.
He did indeed, so we don't really swear on this channel, guys, because that's not fair. If there's younger people watching, then we kind of need to protect the younger ears.
Yes, we do.
So, and we get that. So some guys might sit there and the kids are in the background. Absolutely. Our kids are completely grown up. We've got grandchildren, but... The same applies.
You're not saying any bad words in front of them either.
No, and I'm the most potty mouthed person you could ever wish to meet. Nearly as much as you, Mrs. Moonstomper. Yeah, absolutely potty mouthed. Honestly, it's one after the other after the other. She's gone.
Sorry, sir.
She's gone. Right, so we digress there, don't we?
Yes,
we digress.
Yes,
people like Sid Vicious taking complete advantage of. And that was
so unfair.
But I don't think it was intentional. But things like that just completely crashed it.
Just spirals out of control, sort of thing.
It did indeed. Oh, but, and out of that, talking of subcultures.
Mm.
And in that new wave, Two Tone sprung out of that.
Oh, yes.
Which was a heady mix of punk and reggae. Punk, reggae and ska crashed together. And you can hear that, but go watch our Rude Boy video, or at This Is Two Tone video. And that will tell you, and ska video as well.
Oh, yes.
That will tell you exactly where that came from, so we're not really going to repeat that whole wave. So, springing out a new wave, in the USA you had...
Talking Heads, Dev Owl, B-52s.
Now, the Talking Heads, I think, are amazing. B-52s and Devo, I could really, really, to be honest, I could take all those. Devo's all right. But I've got to be in the mood for that. But Talking Heads, I just think are absolutely amazing. But on the other side of the Atlantic... In the United Kingdom, the bands that started to up and come were, I would say, people from Manchester.
Oh, right.
That was the next big scene.
Yeah.
So when you look at Manchester, obviously Susie and the Banshees.
Yes.
And The Cure also sprang up out of that as well.
Even the Smiths.
The
Smiths, would they be included as well?
Absolutely, they would do. Okay. They would do, but that sort of going into, so it's your post-punk.
Yes.
Your post-punk and that sort of cult. The Cult as well.
Oh, yes.
The Jesus and Mary Chain. That kind of thing. So it was...
The Mission, maybe.
The Mission as well. Yes. So, that's a good Yorkshire band, The Mission.
Yes.
But it's very, very... gothic, wasn't it?
Yes.
So gothic rock.
Really dark, to that dark gothic feel.
Yeah, gothic rock with almost it was as if you got a punk, as if you got a 1970s punk, kind of smartened them up a bit and dipped them in black paint.
Yes.
That's
the colours they wore, weren't they? It's black.
Yeah, it is. It's black, but it was very, very. It was very dark, very moody, and I actually liked that scene. I was lucky enough to see The Cult twice live, and The Mission as well. And I've got to say, I really enjoyed that.
Yeah, that's good.
But then going onto the other side as well, so the Pixies.
Oh yes, and 10,000 Maniacs. Maybe.
Yeah, The Wedding Presents.
And there's also the Go-Go's, where Belinda Carlisle started.
The Go-Go, I mean, that's, yeah, so I can't get my head around that, but that was sort of, that was kind of lumped into that category, wasn't it?
It was, yes.
But that's going back quite some time. So by the 80s, Belinda Carlisle was by herself singing Heaven Is a Place on Earth.
That's it. The late 80s, this was.
Which.
87, 88.
Yeah, which is probably not really true, was it, really? But there you go. Each their own.
Yeah.
Hands up who wants another ropey song from rock. Okay. And then going forward into the 90s, that kind of changed again. So
oh, yeah, it just switches from decade to decade.
It does, but it's rebel songs and anarchy is always there. Yes. So punk isn't just, as we said, punk isn't just 1977.
No.
It's so much more with your rebel and anarchy songs. People like Rage Against the Machine.
Oh, yes.
Who were really, really, really rebellious. When you listen to Balls on Parade, that is really, really two fingers up to everyone. And many of their songs are as well. Yes. Zach LaRoche was a serial protester.
Yes, he was, weren't he?
Absolutely. But, you know, if that's what the guy wants to do, then fair play to him. Yes. You know, it's
each to their own.
Yeah, and the politics isn't for me, but the idea behind it, I think, it's very artistic. And it's a good way to get your points across, if you can do that.
Yes.
I suppose it beats standing in the street waving a flag, doesn't it? but yeah,
definitely.
Like you say, each their own.
Yes.
And then pushing into the 2000s.
Well, before that, wasn't Nirvana, were they classed as a punk, do you think? Or that new wave?
No, so it was grunge rock, wasn't it?
Oh,
it was, it was grunge rock, but when you look at that, and Alice in Chains, and Soundgarden, all from the Seattle scene, then yes, it did spring up out of that. When you look at it, it was very, very, again, very stripped down, very just, it was dark. It was really, really dark, but it was
especially
really
Soundgarden as well. They were dark, weren't they?
Soundgarden were very dark, but Chris Cornell,
yes.
Chris Cornell, what an amazing singer.
Especially when he sang Black Hole Sun.
I like that one.
Yes.
But I would say the Jesus Christ Pose is favourite Soundgarden song. That is just absolutely amazing, and the video to that is absolutely stunning.
Peculiar, isn't it? Stunning, but peculiar.
Oh, no, it's brilliant. It's really, really brilliant, and the rhythm behind that is just absolutely, it's just on point. Those guys, to me, that's when they knocked it out of the ballpark. And Alice in Chains as well, another one who just absolutely wow. They just had that sound. And it was just dark, it was doomy, but it was just something that was, I can see the extension from punk going into that. And do you know what, guys? I think what we're trying to say is it's just good old-fashioned rock and roll.
Yes.
That's what it is. It's just good old-fashioned rock and roll.
First and foremost. Where guys
and girls can pick a guitar up and express themselves with some drums and some bass behind and just sing their hearts out. That's what it's all about. And then going into the 2000s, people, in fact, in the 90s, people like Green Day, who were just, again, an amazing group who just on point. Linkin Park.
I was going to ask you, who came first? Linkin Park or Green Day?
I think Green Day came first, then Linkin Park afterwards.
Yes.
But only slightly afterwards. And then British bands such as Muse as well. So it was independence.
Yes.
The indie sound and the punk sound and the rock and roll sound and the rock sound as well. And it was intertwined. And in my opinion, there's nothing like that anymore. It's kind of gone. And it's a shame, it really has.
You get those other ones that aren't, well, sort of popular, not as big as Linkin Park or Green Day. You get Sum 41 and Blink 182, maybe.
Good Charlotte.
Yeah, Good Charlotte. Because they had that punk at the end, the one of the twins at the end, the Mohawk.
Yes, you're right.
Yes, and the black makeup and the studs and the chains and all
you're
that.
You're right, but then when you look at Mudvayne and people like that, they went into sort of that, but it was just very, very, it was just, I don't know.
It's like death metal in that sort of,
I don't know, did they ever call it new metal or something like that?
It's new metal or death, and they sang with that really dark, that guttural.
New metal.
The guttural shouting.
Yeah, new metal. yeah, but I mean, it's just, you know, I mean, that's, to me, that's metal, not punk.
Okay.
And it's different, if that makes sense.
Sorry.
What? So So, Mrs. Moonstomper.
Yes.
Just before we wrap up, have you got any weird and wonderful facts about Pongs? Because we've had to cover the last 40 odd years in lightning speed.
Yes.
So, what are your facts?
Yes, Shakespeare used the word punk in one of his plays.
Oh, really?
Yes, yes. The Merry Wives of Windsor, Measure for Measure.
Well, who knew that? There you go, here's a weird and wonderful fact for you. The majority of people who wear Ramones t-shirts have probably never even listened to the Ramones. There you go. Any more facts?
Yes, there's a Parisian band called the Stinky Toys. Parisian punk band, sorry, called the Stinky Toys. They're the only band that's a non-English speaking.
The only band?
Yes.
That are non-English speaking?
Yes, the only punk band that's a non-English speaking.
Oh, I thought you meant the only band in the world that's non-English speaking. I was going to say, that's rather...
Do beg your pardon. Yeah. Yes, they're the only punk band that's a non-English speaking.
At that point in time, in the 70s, there are other non-English speaking punk bands. There are hundreds of them, literally. That's at a massive revival, punk. Here's another weird and wonderful fact for you. So, to get Punk's Mohicans, they used to super glue those.
They did, didn't they?
People said talcum powder and Vaseline. No, it wasn't super glue.
Or wood glue as well, I've heard.
Yeah, absolutely. But super glue was when the super glue came out.
Yeah.
That was the absolute just thing.
But some people used to say sugar and water, like that can make a syrupy type substance. I don't know.
I'd much rather use sugar water. You can just imagine super glue.
I know.
Mom. I'm stuck.
Oh, God, yeah, even that. Hurry up, you're going to be late for school. I can't, Mum.
Not that I've ever put super glue in the toilet seat, but I'm just saying, you know, because it could be like that. Right,
badass.
So any more facts about punk?
Yeah, there is. The dance they used to do.
What was that
in
called?
The audience, called the pogo.
I remember that.
Yeah.
Ever so well indeed.
God.
Yeah. So there you go, and another weird and wonderful fact for you. Vivian Westwood and a Malcolm McLaren shop was called Too Fast to Die, Too Young to Die, Too Fast to Live, before it was called Sex.
Oh,
but they thought that was too much of a metaphor and they turned it into Sex.
Oh, but she was a designer. First and foremost, was Vivian Westwood.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah, she was the one behind it all. But there you go.
Ah, yes.
And most people would have you believe that punks are pretty middle class people, a lot of prog rockers.
Oh, no.
Not always the case.
No.
We've demonstrated it with people like Sid Vicious and other people as well.
That's it.
They're just musicians like you, like me. You know, I'm not middle class at all, far from it. So, any more weird and wonderful facts about punks?
I think that's it for now.
Oh, well, I've got hundreds, actually. But, you know, it doesn't matter because it's all, I could sit here all night. It's really not a lot of ridiculous facts. So, Mrs. Moonstomper,
what
have we got coming up next week for the viewers?
Trojan label.
Trojan Records, guys.
Yes.
So, the spirit of 1969, you will not want to miss that. That will be as popular as Rude Boy. That will be as popular as This Is Skinhead. And some of their other popular videos as well.
Yes.
And it's going to be an absolute belter, I guarantee you. Lot with every video. We put our heart and soul into it. We are not experts by any stretch of the imagination. We are not. We don't manage everything. We do our best. If you feel we've ever done something wrong, put something in the comments, let
Please
us know.
Do, yes.
We can take the hit 100%. And it's just to me that's a message for us to get better at this. What I am gonna say is this, and I think Mrs. Moonstomp will agree, over the last week or so, we've had an enormous growth in subscribers. So guys, I know there's people from Venezuela, there's people from Canada, United States of America,
Germany,
Australia, New Zealand, and good old England, Ireland, and Scotland and Wales. Guys, you guys rock. You are all Moonstompers.
You rock.
Whether you've subscribed, whether you've commented, whether you've just watched it, however you've interacted with us, and we thank you so much. from the bottom of our heart.
Definitely.
Some of your comments have really, really touched us, and it's absolutely amazing, it really is. So
yes.
Thank you so much, thank
many
guys.
Thank yous.
And the only way we can thank you really is just by returning the favour and carrying on and bringing out some absolutely amazing content.
Yes.
And we're going to have lots of that. Are we not?
Oh yes.
So
yes.
We've got some more skinhead stuff coming up because I know that's popular. So stick around and stay tuned for that because that's going to be brilliant. We've also got some specials coming up as well.
Oh yes. Yes.
And what we always said, once we reach a sizable amount of subscribers, yes, we're going to look at merchandise. What we're wearing at the moment is okay, but I think it's substandard and I wouldn't want to give out anything that's substandard because I just don't think that's fair.
No.
You know, the idea is you get a quality garment or a quality item that lasts and lasts and lasts. So we are looking at that because a couple of you did mention merchandise.
Yes.
We're not sure how we're going to do that logistically, but
we'll find a way.
We will do, definitely. And the other thing we're going to do as well is once we reach a set number of subscribers, which I think may be 1,000, we've got a superb giveaway, have we not?
That's it.
Where we've got several really, really, really good prizes and the quality prizes as well. So stick around and stay tuned for that.
Stick around.
It will be a prize draw, so wherever you are within the world, we're not sure how we're going to do it yet, whether we're going to ask questions and make it a bit of a bit of a quiz, or whether it's just going to be a random prize draw. But what we'll do is we'll put our email address on the screen, we'll put it in the comments, in the link in the description below, and we'll get it running that way. I think that's the best way of doing this, isn't it?
Or put our heads together and make a proper fence.
That wouldn't be difficult now, would it really? That'd be a big old medieval wooden fence, wouldn't it? Of really, really strong proportions.
Yes.
But there
sturdy.
You go. Absolutely. So, have you got anything else, Mrs. Moonstomper?
I think I have. It's greater than the average bear.
Oh, wow. I don't even know what to say to that. Right, until the next time, guys, I've been Mr. Moonstomper.
I've been Mrs. Moonstomper.
Peace out, guys.
Do what you gotta do, boo-boo.